Hello. Hello, everyone. I am Nikita Lipsky. We will talk today about jigsaw layers. When I was at Java 1 2017, I visited quite a lot of sessions about jigsaw from creators of jigsaw, Mark Reinhold, Alex Buckley, and almost every session was ending with a question: why jigsaw has no versions? When jigsaw will have versions? Or how can we live without versions? And there were no clear answers on these questions. The most direct answer on the question when jigsaw will have versions was never, without any explanations. Honestly speaking, it is not easy to give an answer on those questions on a questions and answers part of a session. So I decided to give a detailed answer why jigsaw has no versions and what jigsaw has instead. But who am I? For nearly two decades, I worked on Excelsior Jet project, which is complete Java SE implementation, JVM, with the head of time compiler. I worked on this project from the day one and contributed to all its components. For instance, I authored Java SE platform split into components that was available to Excelsior Jet users since 2007, 10 years before jigsaw release. I also authored OSGI support at the JVM level, and recently I have added Spring Boot support to Excelsior Jet. So what are we going to talk today? First, the disclaimer. It is not introductory or overview session about jigsaw. So I expect from you that you already know some jigsaw basics. However, I will give some very short introduction to jigsaw that will be enough for you to understand the contents of this talk. Then I will pose the problems that we are going to fight during the session, the jarhell problem, and versioning as a solution for the jarhell problem. Then we will talk about problems about versioning and about jigsaw layers and how to solve the jarhell with jigsaw layers. In the end, I will have some live demo, and if we will have time, I also have some bonus track for you. So let's start. So any module system is all about import and export. Module import something and export something. Extremely easy concept, easy as an apple pie. And modules in JPMS are described in source for files called module-info.java in the source root of your module. So modules become a part of your source code and not some external metadata. And a module imports modules with the requires keyword and exports packages with exports keyword. Modules also can use services and provide services with this and provides keywords. And once import and export is resolved, modules form so-called modular dependency graph. And that's all that I wanted to give you as introductory to jigsaw. Really, modules are a very simple concept. It is import, export, dependency graph, and we are done. But anyway, even with this basic information, we can now pose our problems that we are going to provide during the session, the jarhell problem. And the jarhell problem is most easily illustrated by the following example. Suppose your app depends on on a library foo that depends on a library bus of some version. At the same time, your app depends on a library bar that also depends on a library bus of another version. So if you put both versions on the class path, it becomes unclear what version will be loaded at runtime and if your application will be functional in the end. The most probably one version will be partially overwrite another one, leading into unpredictable program behavior at runtime. And to solve this problem, jigsaw modules might have a version in the first jigsaw drafts. So import-export was qualified by a version. So if two modules require a library module of two different versions, both versions would be loaded. However, versioning was removed later. You may ask, why? Okay, let's discuss it. Let's first think how to implement versioning. So we have a problem. For a given module A importing library lib of version v1 and module B importing library lib of version v2, it is required that both versions of lib work without conflicts. And to solve this problem, Java had class loaders feature since the day one. Class loaders provide unique namespaces, so a single JVM can load two different classes with the same fully qualified name, provided that they're both loaded by different class loaders. So if each module will be loaded by its own class loader, classes of one module won't conflict with classes of other modules. Thus, the case when two versions of one library are loaded by Jigsaw becomes resolved. So we have quite clear problem and quite clear solution. So why not just implement it? What's the problems? So let's discuss it. So in general, when trying to solve the versioning problem, we will inevitably come at some point to the concept that each module should be loaded by its own class loader. And it was exactly so in the first Jigsaw drafts. But let's remember that Jigsaw is not just modules, but also Java SE platform split into modules. By the way, Jigsaw was, had been developed for 10 years not without reasons. One of the main reasons was that it was really hard to split that monolith called RTJAR into well-defined modules with well-defined dependencies without cycles, access, and so on. Fortunately, this job was done, but developers faced with serious problems regarding versioning and Java platform split into modules. For instance, according to that Java platform specification, all core platform classes should be loaded by a so-called bootstrap class loader. It is JVM internal class loader that has no instance. So get class loader from core platform classes should return null. And it efficiently precludes splitting the platform into modules, where each module loaded by its own class loader. You will laugh, but the fact that some misconceive could be unavailable in Java 9 is not backward compatibility problem. But the fact, because Java platform specification never claims that some misconceive should be in Java platform. But Java platform specification claims that core platform classes should be loaded by bootstrap class loader. And changing that behavior would have violated backward compatibility directly. Backward compatibility is still holy cow for Java. JDK developers worked really hard to keep in their hands that everything that was guaranteed by the Java specification of previous versions is guaranteed, is satisfied for a new version. That's why your applications that work on an older version usually work on a newer version of Java without problems, if, of course, your application does not have some reliance on unspecified behavior of a particular Java SE implementation. Moreover, many class loaders can bring backward compatibility problems for your own application as well, because your application may have your own class loaders, and in previous versions, that class loaders the most probably had application class loader as a parent. And now, if all your modules will be loaded by separate class loaders, what should you specify as a parent class loader for your own class loaders? And even the fact that application class loader does not extend URL class loader anymore causes problems. For instance, once author of async profiler Andrei Palgin tweeted, ironically, even official Java 8 demo from Oracle, Java 2 demo, does not work on JDK 11. And the problem is exactly this one, that Java 2 demo tried to cast application class loader to URL class loader. However, it is not backward compatibility problem from JDK point of view. because Java platform specification never claims that application class loader must extend URL class loader. So it is a problem with Java 2DM application itself. It's a classical example of application reliance on unspecified behavior of Java SE, of a particular Java SE implementation. But anyway, if you move to GDK 9+, you may face with similar problems, of course. Now let's think if, oh, shit. Oh, great. It was second time in my career. When Mac, when PowerPoint crashed during the session. So let's understand if versioning really solves the jar-hell problem. So here's our favorite picture with the jar-hell, and that we would like to solve is versioning. So what is the fact that an app has two different versions of the same library? It means that if first library has a class A, then the second library may also have a different class A. And then what does the fact that an app require that the library foo imports module bus mean? It means that it can use that first class A. And the same holds for the second version of class A. And what does the fact that app imports module foo mean? It means that it can use all any of classes of module foo that also can, that can in turn can use our first class A. And thus, first class A appears in the namespace of the module app. And the same holds for the second class A. So we have two different classes A in the same namespace. And now we can hear the following dialogue between them. First class says, I am A. Another replies, no, I am A. And everything blows up, of course. It can be demonstrated by the following. So what I would like to say, the JVM specification defines so-called class loader constraints that prohibit two different classes with the same fully qualified name to appear in the namespace of another class. For instance, in this example, if class B is loaded by L1 class loader and class A is loaded by L2 class loader, then the JVM will check that T1 is the same for both class loaders. And if it is not the case, JVM throws Java lang linkage error. And the problem is not rare. Everyone who plays with class loaders faces with this problem sooner or later when two different classes with the same name start meeting. So versioning does not actually solve the jar-hell problem, but raises it to a new, more sophisticated level instead. And there is one more detail. Import in early Jigsaw versions was qualified by not a single version, but a version range. So a module may declare that it can work with dependency of from version to tor version. By the way, I have found how versions could be described in early Jigsaw drafts. Here we see that module, my module of version 1.0 imports module lib module from 1.2.3.1.2.4.0 with this little bit weird syntax. Why version ranges were important? It is known that if a module can work with some major version of some library, then the most probably it can also work with some newer version of the same library. So if we would stick a dependency requirement to a particular version, it would give too excessive rigidity to the system. So situation when two different modules of two different versions of same library will appear in final configuration will become place quite often. And version ranges could soften the problem in great extent. And prototype on all of this was written. And GCK tests were written. And I remember very well when Alexei Shipilov told me that once a GCK engineer wrote a test on Jigsaw that passed half an hour on quite powerful Oracle workstations. And he submitted a bug, performance report. OK, your resolver resolves too slow. And when GDK developers start fixing this issue, it turned out that the dependency resolution from version ranges is an NP-complete problem. It's simply reduced to 3 threads. And after that, versioning in JPMS breathed its last. Jigsaw architects could not allow to introduce in Java something that could potentially lead to infinity startup time, of course. And if there is no versioning, there is no need for class loaders. And if we have no class loaders for modules, then we have no class loader constraints violation problem, no backward compatibility issues because the set of standard class loaders remains the same, and the resolver became much, much easier. So all problems were solved, except the original one. So how to solve the Jar-Helmer problem now? First, this situation is simply prohibited by Jigsaw. Two different versions of same module just won't get into JPMS, which is good because you will recognize the problem right on application startup and not at an unpredictable point at runtime, wasting a lot of time in debuggers. But you may ask, stop. Jigsaw doesn't have versions, so how it can detect this conflicting situation? And now we can note that the most probably two different versions of the same library have same packages. And Jigsaw prohibits for two modules to have same packages that are called split packages. Okay, that's great that Jigsaw can detect this conflicting situation. But how to solve the Jar-Hel problem after all? If I face it in during development. Now let's remember again about backward compatibility. So Java, as a platform, has a backward compatibility feature. It is natural to expect that libraries that are written in Java also follow backward compatibility rule. So if you face with the situation, it becomes natural to resolve it choosing by the newest version of a conflicting library. Why not? However, libraries are not always backward compatible in reality. So it might happen that library foo does not work with a newer version of library buzz. Then you can try to switch to a newer version of library foo that works with a newer version of library buzz. And playing with the dependency such a way, you will probably find a suitable configuration that works. However, if you have a really big application where dependency graph looks like on this picture, playing with the dependency such a way wouldn't work so good. Remember, dependency resolution problem is NP-complete. So trying to solve this problem manually can make you really sad. So to solve this problem, developers invented another solution that works even on the class path. And the solution is to relocate classes of a conflicting library to different packages. And it can be done even with automatic tools like Maven Shade plugin. However, this solution may not work again because Java has reflection, and reflection it is not always loyal to class relocations. So there's one more solution, to employ class loaders. So if you move conflicted versions to different class loaders, you can solve the problem. You can write such class loaders by yourself, or use a ready-made framework from small ones to big ones that will solve it, this problem for you. However, I don't suggest you overusing this approach. Else you will need to fight with the class loader's constraints violation problem. And even if the framework that you choose addresses this problem somehow, you will have a hard time of refactoring your dependencies when two different classes with the same name start meeting. So yes, we come to the culmination of the session. I will talk about jigsaw layers and now. So yes, the first solution for this problem is to employ native jigsaw mechanism called jigsaw layers. So what is jigsaw layer? A layer in JPMS is essentially a local module system. So when I told you that split packages are prohibited in jigsaw, I was a bit incorrect because they are prohibited in one layer. But if different versions of same module belong to different layers, it is not conflicting situation from jigsaw point of view. And jigsaw itself defines so-called boot layer that contains modules, platform modules that are loaded by Bootstrap class loader, platform extension modules that are loaded by platform loader, and your application modules are loaded by application loader. And your application at any moment can create your own layers that may have modules, the same modules of different versions. For instance, here we see Hadoop layer and JavaScript layer contain different versions of Guava and Jackson. And it is not conflicting situation from jigsaw point of view. And if we see different versions of same library, it becomes interesting how jigsaw layers are implemented from the inside. And of course, they are implemented via class loaders. So each layer has at least one unique class loader, may have several class loaders like the boot layer. And here you can exclaim, what? So what about class loader constraints? Won't we have exactly the same problem that we could have with versions? And actually not, because class loader constraints are impossible to violate by construction of jigsaw layers. Let's understand why. So here's our favorite picture of Jar Hill that we are going, and jigsaw suggests to solve it by moving your application modules to separate layer. The most probably it will be boot layer. And it, modules that cause version conflicts are moved to separate layers as well. So the problem seems to be resolved. However, I feel that it is not everything okay with this picture. Let's play a game. Who will see more differences between these two pictures, except that one has big green boxes around small ones? Any guesses? Who can tell me? Yes, the arrow's direction. So arrow direction means that an arrow direction from A to B means that A imports B. So your app imported module foo before, and now foo imports app. That's it. What does it mean? So every layer has a parent layer. And the modules of child layer can import modules of parent layers without any problems. However, parent layer modules cannot import child layer modules. And that's why it's impossible to violate class loader constraints. Let's remember how we faced with the class loader constraints violation problem. So we had two different classes that were able to meet moving by dependencies downside up. However, here we see that arrows there goes in opposite direction. So these two different classes A have no chance to meet. And now we can hear a completely different dialogue between them. Audio? No audio? Okay. Must be audio here. I can think, okay. There is no space between us, a place that we can't go. Who knows Carol King here? Okay. Go further. Looking at this picture one more time, we can come to a question. Okay. If application modules cannot import child layer modules, then how they can employ functionality implemented in those child layers? And here we can be rescued by the very well-known design pattern called inversion of control. Who knows inversion of control pattern here? Okay, who doesn't know? Okay. The idea of the pattern is as follows. If you have some functionality for implementing another functionality, then instead of importing that functionality, you declare an interface. I need the functionality by this interface. And someone outside will implement that interface and inject into your class. It can be done manually by passing instance of interface implementation to a constructor of your class, or it can be done automatically by dependency injection frameworks such as Spring or Juice. And inversion of control design pattern can be used in Jigsaw as well by using native Jigsaw mechanism called Jigsaw services. So yes, modules of child layers or modules of parent layers cannot import modules of child layers. However, child layer modules can provide services to parent layers. So let's look at our picture again. Here we see that library foo imports module app. It's nonsense, of course. Library modules cannot import application modules. So to fix this problem, we need to add a bit of code of our own application to the separated layers that, on one hand, would import our modules, our libraries, and on the other hand, will provide services to main application modules. And it is the right picture that solves the jar hell problem. So here my theoretical part of my session is coming to end. So let's talk about practical aspects of the subject. How can we use layers within our applications? And today layers are created by programming code. That code is very declarative. So one can imagine a framework that would create Jigsaw layers by some external metadata. But I'm not aware of such frameworks. By the way, I think it's a good idea for open source project. But so now we need to create layers manually by programming code. And so to create layer, first we need to tell Jigsaw where our modules are located. And it is done by creating so-called module finder object. Then we need a parent layer. In most cases, it will be just boot layer. After that, we need to resolve dependencies within our layer. For that, we create a configuration object using a parent layer configuration and a finder, and a set of root modules to start resolving dependencies with. And if we succeeded with creating configuration, we now can create module layer with a parent layer again, and just created configuration, and with a parent class loader that will be used for layer class loader as a parent class loader. And then we can load all services that are provided by this layer by service loader. And now it's demo time. So here I have a very simple application, some extended version of Hello World, that collects Java conferences around the world. but it collects them not by itself, by using so-called JavaConf provider interface that provides conference with a string. And it simply outputs all provider called JavaConference provider interfaces that it founds, just outputs on the screen. And it is a module. It has the following declaration. It exports our JavaConf provider interface and uses all available implementations. And if we run our example now, what does it say? We don't see anything because we don't have any JavaConf provider interfaces. So now let's add some. Let it be J' provider. And J' provider, it is module again, and it provides a JavaConf provider with the following implementation. It just provides string hello from J'. So if we now run the example, we won't see anything again because our main application module does not know anything about the JustEdit module. So we need that module to dependencies of our main application module. And let us add it. Let us add job provider module, but we need to market that module as a runtime dependency because else we will have cycle between the main application module J' provider module. And if we now run our example, oops. Yes, we see hello from J'. So let us add some another provider, J Professionals. Have I switched? Switched. Okay, so it looks exactly the same as J' provider. It belongs to the same package, BDJuke. Its implementation also looks the same, has the same name, JavaConf provider impl, but it returns different string. And we also need to add that module to dependencies of our main application module. We also need to mark it as a runtime dependency. And if we run our example now, we will see the exception, a liar instantiation exception, because package bg.juke in both modules, G Professionals provider and module and J' provider. So we have just simulated our jar hell problem. We have very simple modules in our module path, and Jigsaw was able to detect that conflicting situation. So let us solve it, this problem with Jigsaw layers. And for that, we need first, and we will move J' provider to a separate layer. And for that, we need first to remove J' provider from dependencies of our main application module. And then let us write a bit of code for creation a layer. Again, what's the problem? Okay, so that here we are. So now we will create a layer with the same code that I just shown you on slides. First, we create a module finder object, then we have parent, create configuration, and then create layer. And we pass first argument of a program as a module location, and we'll resolve the only module in that layer. It that called j'.provider. I passed as a first argument location of that module. So now I believe we should see both implementations because j'.provider has its own implementation. It imports. Okay. We see now two different implementations. in spite of the fact that they have the same class in their contents. So we have just solved the jar hell problem with Jigsaw layers. Congratulations. So I see that we have some time for bonus track. Great. So let us move further. Hey. Some problems on my screen. Okay. It was a very simple application, very simple console application, but today Java is mostly used on server side. On the server side, we have a problem. We have a problem that application service today does not know about Jigsaw anyhow. And even the servlet containers are that knows nothing about modules. So you can't tell your Tomcat instance, for instance, where are your modules are. And dependencies war files are plain old class path, in fact. What does it mean? It means that you can't benefit of Jigsaw anyhow on the server side now. If someone saw my last year session about Jigsaw versus OSGI knows that Jigsaw has a mantra, and the mantra is reliable configuration, strong encapsulation. What does reliable configuration mean? It means that Jigsaw guarantees that no required modules are missed in final configuration, and there are no cycles in your final configuration, and there are no split packages, no different versions of the same library. And strong encapsulation means that everything that is not exported by the module is not visible outside, even via reflection. And this mantra does not work on the server side. So I thought that we should not give up. And actually, all those modern application servers are open source. So actually, we can fork our favorite application server and add Jigsaw modular layers into their class loading logic. And I did it for Tomcat, and I would like to share with you the results. So first, let's think how class loading logic looks in Tomcat. Tomcat class path has bootstrap jars that loads all Tomcat jars by separate class loader. And each web application is loaded by its own class loader. What's the problem here? Since Java 9, a class loader can assign a module to classes that it loads. However, if it does not do that, all classes that it loads will belong to so-called unnamed module. It's non-modular, just non-modular code. And even if classes formerly belong to a named module, to a jar with a module minus info.class declaration. And it can be demonstrated by the following example. I have written a classical Hello World application, modular Hello World application, where we have two different modules. One provides Hello World string, and another outputs that string on a web page. And I also output module names of classes of that two modules. And if we run that example on a typical Tomcat, we will see that that classes has no modules and no module names. And on my fork, they have module names, modules and module names. And I would like to share you how I achieved this. So before my patches, Tomcat was loaded by simple URL class loader. After my patches, I created just a modular relay with very similar code that I've shown you on slides. And then I tweaked class loading logic of web application class loader. Before my patch, all classes of web application were loaded from web min minus inf slash classes and web minus inf slash lib locations. I left those places intact and introduced a third place called web inf slash modules. And I create a modular layer from the jars that are located in that place. And I create that layer with a very similar code. But I use a modular layer of Tomcat itself as a parent layer for this layer. And then I use that layer for loading our classes of our web application. And then I got modules at runtime and achieved Jigsaw enlightenment. But you may say, OK, Tomcat is yesterday. All we now have Spring Boot and microservices, and modules are not needed on microservices world. It is a debatable question. We can discuss it later. However, can you face with a similar situation when you use Spring Boot? And the answer is yes, of course, because if you deploy your Spring Boot application in Spring Boot executable jar, then Spring Boot classes of Spring Boot executable jar are loaded by Spring Boot class loaders that knows nothing about Jigsaw again. And hence, you will face exactly the same problem when trying to use Jigsaw with Spring Boot. But fortunately, Spring Boot application can run without Spring Boot class loader if you put all your dependencies on class path. It's called exploded form of Spring Boot. And thus, you can modularize your Spring Boot applications using standard migration paths, so that you put everything on module path first, then you add modular declarations for your own jars. But if you really require one jar deployment, I have an exercise for you. Actually, Spring Boot is open source again, so you can fork Spring Boot application class loader, adding a Spring Boot, adding a modular layer to its logic. Spring Boot has the only class loader, so it seems to be two times easier task than I've solved for Tomcat. And that's all for today. Let's sum up what we've learned today. And so versions for modules look like a good idea, but there are many problems with them. So we have certain backward compatibility problems. It's hard to use versions safely because of class loader constraints. And NP completeness on versions resolution is just on dependency resolution is just showstopper for them to appear in the Java standard. On the other hand, Jigsaw layers allow to solve the jar help problem safely because there are no class loader constraints violation by construction, and Jigsaw services help employing functionality implemented in a child layer from a parent layer. And knowledge about the layers can help you in modularizing of Java application, including server-side applications. Благодаря за внимание то. Вопросы?
Any restrictions on the service return type?
No.
Should it be only primitives and objects?
No, no. You can return. It's regular services. Actually, services are old mechanism that was introduced in Java 1.4. Yes, 1.4. You can declare services in a manifest of a jar file, but now there was integrated with Jigsaw. So you can now declare for a model that it can use or provide services. But the mechanism exactly the same as it was in 1.4.
Yeah, thanks for the talk. Are you familiar with OSGI? Because OSGI has version with dependency resolutions.
Yes,
and I've never heard about anything bad about it.
I recommend you to watch my talk, Jigsaw versus OSGI. You can find it on the internet. Of course, I'm familiar with it because I supported OSGI at the JVM level. So I know everything about OSGI from the inside. And every problem that I highlighted today actually was taken from the problems of OSGI. They have exactly the same problem. They have NP completeness on dependency resolution. They have class loader constraints violation problem. It's hard problem, by the way. And they have many, many of other problems that I highlighted in my talk. So please see.
One question. Can you hear me?
No questions?
Yes. So is there any integration between Maven resolution and Jigsaw models?
If you watched yesterday talk called Java Module System in Practice, that guy highlighted how to use Maven with Jigsaw now. It has now very cool plugins that allow you to use Jigsaw without any efforts.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, thank you very much.